She lived a great life and a horrible life all at the same time. She went through a lot, and I'm going to share a little with you of my mom. And you're going to have to forgive me because this is very tough to throw together and make sure that I can tell you all the things I want to tell you in a short amount of time, because obviously a lifetime of memories is just unbelievable. But some of the things you're going to see, it's just like eye-opening. So everybody thinks their mother is the best in the world. So I honestly will tell you, my mom is the best in the world. But everybody has their little idiosyncrasies and things that they do. My mom kept her fridge entirely full all the time. She would feed anybody all the time. And sometimes she'd have to go and clean it out because there was things in there that were, should never even be there for that long.
Science experiments?
Yes, they were. She would buy things in multiples. So I would get the same shirt as my brother and my other brother. She would go to the store. She could never buy just one thing. She would buy a number of things. And it didn't matter. It was a dollar. She says, it's only a dollar. Yeah, but you don't need 12 of them. I mean, seriously, she would do this. But she had a heart of gold. She would make chicken and rum cakes for all her friends, and the people would come to work at her house, and just a million people, and she was just always that way. And she would buy lottery tickets. So she loved her family. And she would always think that the lottery was the answer. And it wasn't for her. It's so that her kids would be able to live a life that's real easy. So I would get phone calls all the time. She would say, hey, you know what? You need to buy the lottery. Do you know how much it is now? Yeah, Mom, it's $100 million. It's plan B, not plan A. Okay. So that was one of the things. But she was a friend to everyone. And she really was a friend to everyone.
Hi there.
Hi, can I still just check? Sure. Thanks. She raised 4 children, primarily on her own. And she had a lot of things that we got from her. One is the strong work ethics. You know, she always instilled to us that we always needed to do things the right way, all the way from beginning to end. Don't start something and don't finish it. You know, don't start it and not finish it. Honesty, a passion for giving, which obviously, because I'm part of Rotary, you can see that. Forgiving, and the zest for life. So after today, you're going to see why I am like this, and you're going to meet my mom. So I want to introduce you to my mom, Agnes Hoffman. So let's go to here. And let's see.
My name is Agnes Hoffman.
Did you have any nicknames growing up?
In Hungarian, it would be Agi. Like in America, you say Aggie. In Hungary, for short, Agi.
My mom was interviewed and taped for the Dallas Holocaust Museum. Oh, God, I hate when this happens. So I took little bits and pieces of that so you can actually get to know my mom. I was hoping this wasn't going to happen.
What day were you born?
January 21st, 1931.
And what is your current age?
My current age is 83 years young.
And what city and country were you born?
I was born in Hungary, although I was born in Budapest. But I lived in a city called Miskolc all my life.
And your home city, Miskolc?
Miskolc.
Was your family part of a congregation?
Yes. We belonged to the temple and frequented it.
Was it Reform? Was it Orthodox?
No, Reform was something that we really did not even ever see but Orthodox.
And what is the name of the temple?
I cannot tell you.
Obviously, at my mom's age, she can't remember everything from that time, but there's a lot she does remember.
What do you remember? What do you remember of that?
We lived in a beautiful little place. There were about four individual houses. People were very close, but mainly my father. He had created a place of heaven on earth. He had given us so many happy times even there. There was a company just next, in the next building, and we were little children, and they had, they were working on different things, and they had brick there, and we would go there just outside the door right next door, and we would take something and beat the brick to powder, and we call that paprika.
Which now I know why she puts so much paprika in her stuff all the time. And I know it's Hungarian, but that's, you know, that was mom.
I love to do things with my family. It was a very extended life that we did a lot of fun things with my parents. My mother was the most beautiful, precious, sweetest woman. She was only 35 years old when they took us away.
Now I know why. She loved family so much. And it's been really difficult because I never met them. God!
You're fine.
You're good. Good.
I thought 3 months is enough time.
No, never, never.
Yeah, we'll get through this. All right.
What was your favorite thing to do while living in Michigan?
Don't laugh. I could go to the movie theater, mainly one, the closest one, free. Anytime I could go and see a movie. My friends loved me, needless to say, because I could bring them also free. So I loved when they would come with my friends and make them happy. They were just so happy. I was a princess to them.
My mom used to, at night, she would watch movies, old movies, at home on TV. And it didn't matter. It was a black and white TV, a color TV. She would, I mean, to this day, she could tell you every old Doris Day movie or, you know, Rock Hudson movie or anything. I mean, she loved movies. Now I know why, because, you know, it was part of the family. So this is a little history. Her father was Bellum. And he was born in December 1st, and we're not sure exactly the day he died because he was taken to concentration camp. He was taken to Auschwitz first and then transported to Buchenwald on July 14th. He arrived there on the 16th, transferred to Bergen-Belsen, which is right next door to there, to Auschwitz, on the December 29th. We're not sure how long he lived. And it was really kind of heartbreaking, and this piece came from part of my mom's things, but he was taken, but he didn't want people to know who he was. So we went under a pen name. And that's how the family wasn't put together as far as, you know, everybody taken at the same time. My grandmother, Anna, she was taken to concentration camp and actually died there in Auschwitz, along with the three daughters who are the sisters of my mom. So they all died at the same time. So dads are kind of important. They're the kids.
One of our old valued parents.
My father was in the movie business. He traveled to Budapest every few days. He was in charge to choose what they should bring to us, and it was always every one of the best and the newest movies. And he was also a writer. He wrote a book. He wrote a lot of movie manuscripts, and he also wrote novels. So he was very, very talented. He had taken me to Budapest for a visit. I had an aunt living there, a cousin's, and when I went there, I stayed with them. And it was always so special because he was very fantastic about creating. And when he took me to Budapest, he had shown me so many exciting things. Also, he brought the only children's theater from Budapest, the very famous children's theater. He brought them to Miskolc. Well, it never happened that they could bring them out of Budapest, but he brought them to Miskolc and had them perform there for a few weeks. It was fantastic. So he was very talented in many fields.
All right. Now we're going to get to my mom's sisters. And three sisters, Susie, which is Susie in American. She was 11 years old when she died. Eva, the young one, was 3 years old, and Elsa was 5. Now my mom at that time, she's the oldest, she was 13. And so that's, you can see the range. Now I know why my mom had 4 kids. And I think in the back of her mind, she wanted to have 4 kids because of her family. My sister is named Susan. We call her Susie all the time. Now she goes by Sean, which is kind of weird. But.
The youngest was 2 years old, Eva. She won the National Beauty Contest in Hungary. She was the prettiest child in Hungary. And Elsa, and she was 6. And Susan, was 11. And I was 13.
Did your family ever think about leaving Hungary?
Yes, in those times, we had relatives in America. And my uncle came here many, many years prior to that, about 20 years before they were settled.
My claim to fame now is I'm related to Adolf Zucker. He is the one and only founder of Paramount Pictures, and a very, very, very wealthy person. I got none of it. But I will tell you that he was very generous, and I think that's part of where our family got generosity. Very unbelievable person.
Had friends, Jewish, Christians, there was no difference. And like Christmas time, our neighbors, the Christian neighbors, they hung special Christmas ornaments for us children when we came. It was fun. And we enjoyed the life with our neighbors and friends.
It was very difficult. And so, Mom growing up, she had, everybody was her friend. It didn't matter whether you were white, black, you know, a different religion. It didn't matter to my mom. She was pretty cool.
I went to the movie theater one day. This movie theater, when the owner built this beautiful thing, his apartment up there, and he built the lounge, and the German soldiers came and they took over his apartment. They just took whatever they wanted. I had a girlfriend with me in the movie theater, and when we came out during intermission, there were the German soldiers were there in the lobby. And I heard them speak German, and I guess they may have said something. And they talked to me, and then I answered in German. But then they said, "We are going to wipe the Jews off this earth." And little old me, 30 years old, stupid, little, just being proud, I said, "I am Jewish too." I was smart enough to know not to say anything about my being Jewish too. But I said it. I wanted to see his reaction. And then he started to show me pictures of his family, his little children. He wanted to be nice and friendly. And that was it. And then when I came home, I told my mother what happened. And she said, "Aggie, from now on, you don't go out at all."
I remember her telling me that a long time ago too, you know. You can't go out, you can't do this, you can't do that. So the takeover of Hungary was kind of like immediate, but it ranged over a number of weeks and months. But the hard thing was is for everybody to get to the point where you actually can live a real life, especially if you were Jewish and if you were living in Hungary and Poland and a couple of the other countries. So this is a little about my mom when she lost her dad.
They took away stores, they took away public places, they just moved into them, and Jews could not take public transportation. Jews could not do a lot of things. And we didn't have a life anymore. They took away their stores, their livelihoods. And that was the change. That was it.
How did this affect your family directly?
by parents, by family, and other people, neighbors, and everybody was concerned because they knew that it's going to be the same thing as was in other countries, the Polish and Czechoslovak people, were the first ones who were taken to Auschwitz. After that came Hungary and some other little countries in Europe.
How did your parents react to not being able, I know you said your dad traveled a lot, how did he cope with not being able to travel?
We had to wear the yellow star on our clothes, so they knew who was Jewish, so they couldn't have traveled on public transportation and could not do a lot of things. So my father took off his star, and he had gone to Budapest back and forth. One day he was standing at the station waiting for the train, and the Hungarian Christian, he walked over to a German SS, and he said, "There's a Jew." So they went over to him and said, "What's your religion?" And he said, "Jewish." He had to say it. He had to, probably he would have had to show. And they took him away.
So that was a really tough thing for my mom. And in a few minutes, you'll hear a little more and you'll see some things about more of the stories. And the hard thing is that, like I said, there are so many things and stories, and my mom wrote a lot of things. And over the weekend, I spent like 2 days just reading and going through all these things and like, wow, which ones am I going to tell you about and which ones am I not going to tell you about? So I tried to get a couple of the real highlights of this. So what happened next is what I'm going to tell you. The Germans came and they took the family house and sent the entire family to what they called the ghetto. And the ghetto was like 33 blocks long in an area of Germany that basically you lived in poverty. You had nothing, literally. It was a ghetto. They took their father, their mother, the sisters, the grandmother, and the great aunt. Now, when they actually came to the house to take them away, they said, "Lock the door and give the keys to the Germans, and you're allowed to take only what you could carry. It's pretty much a pillow and a blanket, and maybe if you had one item of clothing you would take." And that's all they could take. So in the process of doing this, this is such a unique story. They were leaving, and the postman was coming. And they had already given the keys to the Germans. And what they did was, the postman gives a postcard to my mom, and it came from her father, and said, "To my sweetest Aggie, you're old enough now to read this book, Tolstoy's War and Peace. Take it. It's on the shelf." Well, what had happened is, Bella, who's her father, had written a book on the war, and he had it located right next to that book, and nobody knew it, except now they knew it. The toughest part is that they couldn't go back into the house to get it, so it was destroyed, and we don't ever know what happened to it. So the ghetto, like I said, was 33 streets long, and Mom worked as a young child at 13. She would serve food, so it would almost be like Meals on Wheels, but it was for a Jewish organization that would serve meals to the families in the ghetto. But then the Germans came, and they herded them together, and they put them in what they called cow wagons, really, or boxcars. And they would put 60 people in a boxcar. They traveled for 1 to 2 days to Birkenfelsen, where they exited, and they were herded into lines. And old people were told to go to one line, old people and young children would go to one line, and women 18 to 35 would go to a different line. And for some reason, they sent my mom to the line for the women of 18 to 35. Separated her entirely from her mother and her three sisters. And so it was the Germans that actually, there was one German SS and said, "No, this is where you go." And then they said, "This is where you go." And of course she's crying and screaming, and "I want to go with my mom and my sisters." And she said, "No, you stay right here." And she was continually doing this, and another SS came and said, "You can go over there with your family." And the German SS that said originally to go here said, "No, you stay here." Little did we know, saved their life. So they used to make them walk all the time. They walked and marched 75 kilometers, which is almost 47 miles, to Auschwitz. And they there was no transportation. They made them walk in hand. They shaved their heads, and they had them sleep on cold floors with no pillows or blankets. They had them pick up one summer dress. So the kid, so my mom was able to go, after they shaved her head, they said, "Okay, you go and you get one of these pieces of clothing." And it was a white dress, but it was an adult size. Well, no kidding, because she's 13 years old, and they sent her to where she wasn't supposed to go. So, she adapted pretty well. She tore the bottom off, and she put it on her head because she was no hair now, and it was cold. But after the SS saw that, they actually took it off her head, slapped her, and made her cry. And that's kind of tough for a little kid. Mom had a best friend that she made in concentration camp. Her name was Blanca. And Blanca was 5 years older than my mom. And they used to hang out and do things, and as time went on, Blanca became a nurse, and they made my mom the messenger girl. And what they used to do, and there's a word for it, and I just couldn't pronounce it, so I said, "Well, I'm not going to put it in here." But she would go from barracks to barracks and deliver the messages. So if somebody would say, "Okay, you have to move them," whatever, she would go and tell them. And then she would also have to talk to the SS soldiers, which really terrified her. It was kind of very scary at that point. But they assigned people jobs in factories. And mom was chosen because they check your hands and see how frail and how nimble they are. And they look at your eyes. And my mom had blue eyes. So that right then and there was a real important thing, because Germans, they figure, well, if you have brown eyes, you're Jewish and you're not worth anything. So mom was chosen to work in the ammunition factory, and she was doing things on airplanes, little pieces. They gave her a tweezers, and off she went. Dr. Mengele, the angel of death, probably the most noted horrible German in the history of the world. He used to operate on people, and he would come to the locations of each of the barracks, and he would look for the old and the sick, and then take them away, and they'd go to the gas chamber. So whenever he showed up, everybody was totally terrified, and could you imagine? You would never want to be sick. Well, you're not eating a lot, and you're working, and so
you're going to get sick and you're going to get frail and you're not going to make it. And a lot of people didn't make it. So Mengele actually had a girlfriend, Riesel. I mean, could you imagine that kind of a name, Riesel? Well, you would think of a big, giant German woman, you know, that's terrifying. She wasn't. She was beautiful. Braided hair, and when she looked in your eyes, it was terrifying. It was like penetrating. It's like you're dead. So nobody would want to look into Griesel's eyes because they were all afraid that she would like you're gone. And that's the way it was. So after that, what saved my mom? Well, I think part of it is that she spoke German. And they called her, and I can't say it in German, I don't know what it's worded, but the little one with blue eyes. And that's what they called her. One of the SS women the SS women were not totally trained like soldiers. They were sort of like people that came in and they weren't really trained well until after a while they learned what the SS really wanted to do. So there was one woman who would move my mom from place to place, knowing that if this barracks was going to go to the gas chamber, they would take her and move her to someplace else. The one thing is that they had a count. So if there's 60 people in a barracks, and there's 61 over here, there's a problem. So what they did was they would take one from there and put them over there, and they would take my mom and put her over there. She was extremely lucky. Somebody really was watching over her. She was chosen to work in the factories, which is sort of good and bad, because she spoke different languages. But the one person that would always make the decisions on where you're going to go was one woman who got to know my mom and really liked her. And so whenever they said, okay, well, you know, I want to go here or I want to go there, she would say, no, before you're offered this, before you're going to do that, you come to me and you ask me, and I'll let you know if you can do that. So somebody, again, was watching over her. Then what came next? Well, they moved in multiple factories, and they went to Wasser. And they walked for days. And they had no transportation, so they literally made you grab your clothes, whatever you have, and walk to the next place. They walked for 10 to 12 hours a day, and they really had no food. Their breakfast consisted of one pot of black coffee. And what they would do is, it was one pot. So you would take a sip and pass it on. You'd take a sip, you'd pass it on. So by the time you got done, there might not be any coffee left. The other thing they had for lunch was a soup made of grass and greens. And it was kind of gritty and dirty. And I'm not sure exactly what it was made of, but Mom described it as grass. Like literally, go out, pick up grass, put it in some, you know, pot of water and boil it. And then for dinner, they gave you either one slice of bread. You could have either. You can't have all. You can have one slice of bread, or bite of cheese, or one teaspoon of marmalade. And now, could you imagine existing life this way? And continually working? No wonder things were like they were. You know, many of them died. So I'm going to fast forward through the concentration camp. The Allies, you know, obviously she's working, she's doing things, she's growing up. The Germans, the Allies were coming. And there was all kinds of discussion of what's happening. And the Germans always said that if they're going to have to give it up, then they don't want to be caught with all of these people dead or, you know, dying, because then they, in turn, would be massacred. So they herded all these people into the meadows. There were guns drawn. Last minute, soldiers were ordered to don't touch them. And then they put them all in boxcars and they shut the door. So that way, if the Allies came, they would not know they're there. Well, that's kind of obvious, they are. But they had 60 of them to a boxcar. They would open the door every 3 days, which is horrific. And they gave them a handful of dried oatmeal and no water. So how do you exist? So many people died in the boxcars. This lasted about 2 weeks. And when they opened my mom's boxcar, the Allies did, there were 54 people dead, 6 living, one of which was my mom. I mean, it's a miracle. So the war ended. They were sent to Denmark first. They were given hot meals, warm blankets, a really, you know, clothing, because Denmark was a place that would accept the German concentration camp people. So 5,000 were turned over to the Swedish Red Cross from Denmark, and my mom was one of them. They were given, and they gave you something when you left, and they gave my mom a little suitcase, which I really wish I'd loved to see a picture of this little suitcase. And she took it with her, but she ended up in a hospital. And part of the story that you don't know is that she actually had to take a train ride, and she was with another couple, and they were married, or they were engaged. And my mom, for some reason, had to get off the train, and so did he. And they got off the train, and the train took off. So now his wife is on the train, and this guy is on the, you know, with my mom, and my mom's a young kid, and it's like, now what do you do? Her suitcase is on there. So now she's gonna lose her suitcase. So it goes around, and finally, you know, they call and say, okay, there is a lost and found, or you call the hospital. So they got in transportation and they tried to get to the next place. When they did get back on the train, the fact was is that they actually had the woman who was the fiance of the gentleman had taken her stuff and put it in her room. And so she got the suitcase back, which is amazing. And it's a great story, and there's a lot to it, but obviously I'm just giving you the Cliff Notes version of it. She taught herself Swedish. So my mom knew Swedish, English, German, Hungarian, and part Polish, I think. But she was very bilingual. But she taught herself by taking the dictionary and teaching her own self Swedish. So in Sweden, when she got there, she attended boarding school and then went to live with a wonderful family. This family had lots of money, great people. But then she went to work on a farm and lived in tents. So it's sort of like a whole cycle of where she was and back in there. She attended, so after that she became well noted because she actually knew people. And she attended this UN World Peace Conference in Switzerland. And it was because she was bilingual and she was speaking Swedish, counsel had sent her. And so here you have Nobel Peace Prize winners and great professors, and they're all speaking, and she's there as a young kid. I'm sorry, not a young kid, a young adult by now. And it was kind of very, very interesting. She wanted to do that. But then after that, there was a very wealthy family that talked to her beforehand and said, we want you to come to be our governess. And she said, no, I want to do this and go to the peace conference. And so she did that. And then she ended up going to work for this very wealthy guy, and he owned a steel company. And so mom really, like some of the pictures that we have are just unbelievable. You know, I mean, it's a huge mansion and lots of, you know, lots of money. And it is very interesting to see. Let's go here. So, how did she get to America from Switzerland? I'm sorry, so Sweden. Again, my mom was 19 years old and she got on truly the Queen Elizabeth. With tons and tons of people. But my uncle a great uncle, the officer, paid for it all. I mean, it was, after the war, people would always say, oh, I'm a relative of yours, can you help me, can you, you know. But because my mother's grandmother was the sister of Adolf Zucker. So we knew, and she had known because she had seen him as a young child and what he's done. So his generosity was unbelievable. So he gave my mother's grandparents and daughters $3,000 each when they had a wedding. And this is early 1920s. Anna's, and so her mom got $500. When Adolf heard of the grandfather's mill burning down, he sent $40,000 to rebuild this thing in a huge manner. Much, much nicer than it was ever before. That would be equivalent to a few million dollars in today's market. He saw, when he saw 100 Jewish children in the primitive peasant school with no religious education, because again, you know, the Jewish religion, there was, you know, you had to go to temple. Well, they had no religion. So what did he do? He built them a school and brought in the teachers and paid all their salaries. And then he used to spend weekends in Greece. And so that's a town that's, you know, obviously in Hungary. He built them a huge monument, and it still stands today. And I'd love to go there and see it. My sister, I believe, saw it when they went to Hungary a few, probably 5 years ago or so with my mom. So I always like to look at this because we actually have a manifest of when they came to the United States. And so I, you know, we're looking through it. My mom, my sister went to Washington, D.C., and she got lots of records that we were able to pull. And this was one of them. And so this is my mom when she came to the United States. And so I called my sister this morning and I go, hey, there's a real discrepancy. That's a Cleveland address. She came to New York. And so we're still discussing. She has family in Cleveland. She had gone to Cleveland for a while, but I think she had probably put down the Cleveland address when she came and then went back to New York. So we're still trying to figure that piece of it out because mom never told us these things. And so if you have any family members you want to know about, talk to them now before they go anywhere. So my mom did get married in New York to my dad, Kenneth, and we had four children. They had four children. I'm the oldest. Susie is the next. Carrie, and then Craig is my youngest brother. So you can see us when we were here, and this is what we look like now. It's kind of crazy, but
used to be so cute.
But now more fun. So my mom had a number of jobs, and when she came to New York, this is what she was.
After I came to America, about a year later, to my amazement, I got a letter from a modeling agency asking me if I would like to model for them. These were the pictures they took of me. I was delighted to be able to do something like this after long life of suffering. After my divorce, I was contacted by a newspaper. They wanted to had me make a promotion for them in the regular newspaper about traveling. And these are the pictures they sent to see all the type of people that travel. After my 40th birthday, I got one more chance to model for these pictures. I enjoyed these the most because it was outside in the open. It was a lot of fun.
It was kind of a trip as a kid to see my mom. Obviously, I didn't see her, like, I don't remember her in the first part of things, but I remember her wearing these crazy things, and I was like, oh my God, Mom, I can't look at these pictures anymore. It's just insane. She was very wonderful and very vain at the same time. She was a character, loved it. So, go to the next one. So Mom had a couple of different jobs, and she was a Scandinavian Airlines flight attendant when she was young. So she's pretty diverse for a girl who grew up with her background, and even though she was educated, it was completely different than what we would think about in this today. People going to, you know, grade schools, this college, master's degree, doctors, and so forth. So that's my mom when she was working for Scandinavian Airlines. So at that point then, we moved to Chicago, actually Park Forest, when I was a little kid. And this was still with my father. So Mom was really accomplished. She was the first woman commodity broker in the United States. She worked for Siegel Trading, downtown Chicago. It was amazing. And people couldn't believe it. And the interesting part of that was she used to take the train from Evanston down there. And she ran into, she talked to this guy all the time, this college student from Northwestern. And the kid would say, hey, you know, so where are you going? Oh, well, I'm going to get an interview at Amtrak because I'm a college student. She goes, oh, really? How can you do that? And the guy tells her and says, my son would like to do that. Really? So she got home. She said, Keith, here's who you call. Here's what you do. You can go down and see if you can get an interview. So
did you know you wanted to work on
Amtrak? I did not know at that time. I was thinking more of the airlines. Like, yeah. But so anyway, I did. I went down there, interviewed. They gave me the job, and I worked summers and Christmas holidays for Amtrak when I was in college. Which is insane. All because she met this guy on the train. She appeared on two different television shows, Concentration, which, you know, for the younger folks, we really don't remember that stuff. But that was a great show. So she was on there for 3 days. It was like almost a record. She won tons of stuff. Day one, she won a fur jacket, a cruise to Bermuda, which I went on, a hi-fi set, cultured pearls, a floor polisher, which I have no idea what that was, and two suits for my dad. On day two, she wins a dinette set, kids' swimming pool, a backyard gym, and tickets for two to every Broadway show in New York. It's insane. And then day three, she sort of fell down a little and she just wanted a camera. But it was kind of cool because she had done that. She was also on another show, and when she was, you couldn't be on the show within a year from the other one. So she had to wait till the end of the year, and then she was on The Price is Right. And she won a backyard glider. So we were very lucky, and I think I got my mom's luck from everything. So this is a really cool story. Blanca, I told you about, they grew up together through the concentration camp. Well, after a while, they lost track of each other and thought each other was dead. They didn't know each other, was still alive. In 1968, my mom, and I'm gonna read this to you, because this is unbelievable, but they randomly met in New York 24 years later. And this is a letter from my mom. She goes, in January 1968, Chicago, I worked downtown in a financial district as the first lady commodity broker in this country. I never dreamt that it was a store, that what was in store for me that day, a couple of days before my birthday. I had to go to this building I've never seen before. I had bought a statue, and I was standing in the lobby guarding it until I was picked by my car. Bored waiting, I amused myself looking around, watching people. A woman got off the elevator and stood at the end of the lobby with her back to me. I admired her clothes. It looked like a French courtier design. People here don't wear such sharp clothes. It turned out she made it her own clothes. She turned around and my heart was beating fast. I knew this woman, but from where? She looked like somebody I used to know very well. Not being able to leave my statue, I yelled at her, "You, over there, I know you." She came over to me, and she had that puzzled look on her face. With that accent, she asked me, "What is your name?" Realizing she, from her accent, she was Hungarian, I answered, "Agi," which is my Hungarian name. She burst out crying and said, "I'm Blanca." Wow! Like, how do you do that?
Wow.
It's 24 years later, since they had spent almost a year together in a concentration camp. Towards the end of the war, they were separated and were both thought that each other was dead. It was the best birthday present ever. A priest was in the lobby and blessed us. So she covers all bases.
She's Jewish girls.
Of course. That's a good Jewish mother. So pretty soon, there were reporters from everywhere, and the Chicago Tribune sent their article to AP and UP, which sent all over the world. My uncle saw it in Australia, and we got letters from people everywhere. So that was kind of a unique thing. So this was, you can't really see this, but the article is there, and this is actually a copy of the article, so if you guys want to ever see it afterwards, you know, I'll welcome to show it to you. So, randomly, Mom, you know, reunited with Blanca, and they were still friends for the longest time. Blanca moved. I met her, which was kind of cool, and then, of course, Blanca passed away, and of course, now Mom has passed away. So, that's my mom. She always had this thing. My children say I see things through rose-colored glasses, but I am the one who colors it rose, because she always was the one who saw things in her own way and always believed it. She passed away July 5th, 2017. She was 86 years old. When you saw the video, she was 83, and that was taken a couple of years ago. She is survived by the four of us, myself, Susie, Carrie, and Craig, three grandchildren, Philip and Christina, PJ and Christina, who are my kids, and Laura, who is my brother Carrie's child, and then two great-grandchildren, Layton and Ryland, or Rye, which are my grandchildren, and my wife, Lori, PJ's wife, Carrie, and Carrie, my brother, his wife, Robin. So that's the story of my mom, my history.
That's
crazy. It's kind of wild, so.
Was your mom, did your mom have the tattoo, or did they not tattoo the kids?
They did not tattoo my mom.
Okay.
Which was some, I don't know why, but that's, she never had it.
How did she speak German? Was it just because she was learning in school at that point in time?
I think she learned it when she was in Hungary, because back then there was a lot of European influence from the Germans and things, and so mom was pretty smart in her own way, and she would, you know, get to know and learn things.
Yeah.
So,
I mean, it's interesting you say there was luck involved in this, but clearly she knew how to work her personality and, you know, made relationships with people along the way to, create her own fortune. I mean, it's remarkable.
And, you know, her generosity was always unbelievable. She always wanted stuff for the family. And so, like, when we were kids and they were divorced, my parents were divorced, my mom would take us on vacations. And she would take us, we went to Colorado, you know, we went to Puerto Rico, which was, I don't know where she happened to know people or guys or whatever it was, but we stayed at the best places and everything was really cool. Pirates of Penzance, okay? I could probably tell you every word in that because we saw it every night in Puerto Rico for 3 weeks. But it was really cool. So, you know, we really enjoyed doing things with mom and growing up. She was always doing things for us and keeping us going and instilling to us the right things to do. So,
you know, it's funny because you hear stories about you going to Kentucky Derby and getting yourself down to the finish line for one of the races, and he realizes how you got that skill set because of Aggie.
That's true. You know, there's some things that I got from mom. Although, you know, she would call me all the time and say, "You got to buy this lottery ticket." I go, "Oh my God, mom, will you please stop it?" You know, and or I go, and towards the end of her life, you know, she was, we brought her from Texas to Brookdale up in Vernon Hills, and she was there for a while in an independent portion of it, and then we would move her to the assisted portion because she was just getting a little, you know, needing assistance, and I think, you know, at that point she wasn't really thrilled about that, and she was starting to forget things, and so, you know, a lot of times we would go, "Okay, mom, who am I?" She goes, "Ah, I know you." I go, "I know, who am I?" She goes, "I know, Dad." And she'd like, "Call me Dad," and I was like, "No, I'm not your dad." "Okay, I know, and you're Keith." "Yes, you're right. Who's my wife?" Oh, I mean, like, we were trying to get her memory to keep going and going. So after a while from there, then we she had a slight, not a slight, but a heart attack. And so then we, you know, got that taken care of, and her mind was going a little more. And we moved her closer to here. So, and I say here because I live in Downers. My brother lived in Buffalo Grove, but he, and his business was in Vernon Hills. So he would go there all the time, but then he decided to move to Chicago. So here he is in a downtown high rise right on the lake across from, you know, Soldier Field, but his business is still there. So he was still going back. I thought, you know what? I think it's best if I could do this here. And so we moved her to Aurora, and that's, you know, pretty much where she stayed for a short time before she passed away. So, she was wonderful. So I really appreciate it. Let me share this with you. If you have any questions or anything, let me know. So,
thank you, Keith.
Thanks. Thank you.